Wie gesagt, also from your life, and I think this always has two sides. That's what I have discovered. There is the outside, like how we do it, and then the side. And it's so much harder to speak about the inner side than it is to speak about glamorous projects that we've done with clients. So I'm going to dare today to speak with you about the inner side, like what it takes to do what you have been describing right now and what your clients are doing when the company's culture is not there yet. And people joining creative companies, of course, they have creativity in their blood, I guess, right? And so often they're like rebels, and there is a great organization called Corporate Rebels, like people who want to change everything. And I've been one of those for many, many years of my 10 years in large corporations, like Toby was mentioning, 6 years at P&G, 4 years at PayPal and eBay. So I've seen the large corporations, and I've also seen small startups that I've been helping develop in leadership positions. And also by training, I did physics and economics, but I focused on the human side, because that's what attracted me, like brain research and how does collaboration and how group dynamics evolve. So I'm trying to bring some of these things to you today to help us focus on both, on the outer side of success and structure and the inner side that make it easier for us to get there. Many of you are designers, and I love working with designers just because it is the spirit that I like to engage in. And obviously, when we ask ourselves, like, how can a corporation design itself for the future, because that's what many of us want them, then design seems to start with also, again, the outer stuff, like making things aesthetic, designing experiences, designing systems, and now we are starting to see people designing organizations. Because what we are seeing, this is a German example, it's not enough. I mean, these are two very popular German companies, and they have had the same kind of stuff on the shelves, the same locations. Oh, shoot. There's a bucket contact. That's fucking in English. I don't think it's my plug. I've got another one of these. Should I try and get that? I'm sorry for the interruption. So, I can continue with the story about those two companies, because it's so obvious. Two companies who have the same products on shelves, the same locations in the city centers selling household goods, and one of them went bankrupt, the other one is flourishing like crazy. And this is always my best example of why culture matters.
Should have brought this from the beginning. So let's see if PowerPoint recovers. Do we have the connection? Single screen. I'm so sorry.
The mouse is there, so there is connection.
Okay. What's that green screen? That's an interesting one. So this company went bankrupt, and this one, this German text is saying, like, I'm human, and that's why I like to shop here. And even if this was just a marketing claim, it would still be interesting to see the difference in the atmosphere that's being created. So today, many companies are struggling to design culture to be more of that right-hand side, this doesn't work either, but this, of the right-hand side culture and be less prone to the risks over here. Many of the large German companies, though, at least I think, are really at risk. Interesting, this works here and doesn't work there. Have you seen that magic? Yeah. So many companies are having cultures that put them at risk to get here. And I don't think there is any executive team in German companies these days who doesn't sense that they are at risk to end up here, just because they become less and less relevant to the people, the employees are less and less satisfied. And most of the clients that we work with, and this is some of the companies I personally was engaged in, they all, and this slide is similar to yours, and I share similar issues. And I think the most important really is employee motivation, because that's the source to so many things. And so many companies have the issue of people being burnt out, disengaged, and you've seen the studies year over year. A more subtle issue is, even when the company is doing well, people think like, well, why should we change anything? We are ahead of the market, we are great. And this slide is based on an idea by Jeremy Abbott of Google, who shared it with me. What people don't understand is the emergence of innovation, how fast it can go. So just being good today does not mean that you will be leader forever, right? And everybody, I mean, you talked about complexity, knows that complex systems tend to have this exponential behavior all over the place. And humans are hard to, we have a hard time predicting that. And complacency makes it even more difficult to kind of be still humble enough to anticipate that other companies might do better than we do. Real innovation is happening there. That's what we all struggle for. Some companies have it in their genes just because they hire those people. Others have hired other kinds of people. And I'm going to speak about the differences in those cultures in a minute, right? So for some of us, this is this is daily life. We innovate and we live to change things, to disrupt. But many companies are soaked with people who are living to stabilize systems and to avoid any kind of change. For us as leaders, the difficulty is to design for the unknown in that way, right? Because if I am running a company that's large and successful, like the Siemens's, Deutsche Bank's, SIPs, I guess, of this world, if I want to lead change, it means I lead myself into the unknown and my people. So how do I do this well? And what's even more difficult, agility is something that's necessary as an enabler for innovation, as we hear so often these days. And agility is something that there is no blueprint to get there. A very simple idea that helps us start getting a feeling for the complexity of really effecting change is when you observe kids playing games. I have three boys, and I love playing with them, and I love watching them play. And what I really find interesting is, like, assume these kids are playing this game now. How comes change? So one of them has this idea of, let's play something else. What can that kid do to convince their colleagues of changing the game? If you immerse yourself in the situation, yeah, thinking of either your own childhood or just looking at the scene, if one of them has an idea, like, what can he do to instill change, to have the kids play a new game, right? I'm going to explore this question because I think this is very crucial to, and very simple, very accessible, as a metaphor for what it really takes. And even though you might think, well, kids play is none of our business, I think, and our thesis is that there is no difference. When we are playing business, we are still in the mindset of what we've learned when we grew up, how to get ideas through, how to convince others, how to defend ourselves, and so on. So if we want to encourage change in organizations, it's a good exercise to reflect what kids could do. There is one point that I really want to make very clear up front. So many companies and boards and CEO teams and executive teams that we work with have this idea of, okay, now everything must change. So all they speak about is change. And I really encourage you, when you engage with your colleagues in terms of changing something, help them define with you what should stay, what should reside. Yeah, it's this idea of German Standbein and Spielbein. So, yes, we want to change, but we need the supporting leg to have the stability to change anything. So the benefit of in engaging people in the change initiative, first of all, to define what should stay, what should not change, is twofold. First of all, it comforts those who anyway don't really like change because it hasn't been part of their DNA so far. And also, it gives you the credibility to really see the entire organization and not just push some crazy idea through. So this is, in our projects, the most important step, first of all, to help people define what should stay. And really obsessed with that, because it's difficult. It's the question, like, what defines us? It's the question, what are we good at? It's the question of, what are we proud of? And then this discussion can still lead to, okay, even if we are proud of that, we might change it, right? But then there has been space for everybody to be heard. And it's not just the drivers of disruption that dominate the scene. I don't speak much about psychology here today. And yesterday you heard a great talk that I missed, unfortunately, but I think what I put here on the slide, based on research from Google, very much coincides with what was said yesterday. So if people look at, Google have researched internally based on lots of data, like what makes teams effective and performant. And Google is a very metrics-driven company, so you can expect this to be quite valid. And I like that third point. So meaning is desire, right? Like something is meaningful to me, that means I want it, I want more of it, I care for it, I do this automatically. The opposite of desire is fear. And what Google prove with their internal research this year has been that when there is an environment of fear, people will not perform. When there is fear, people will not perform. That means when your change initiative brings fear to the people of losing the job, of an uncertain future, of not being relevant anymore, of yada, 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 then you will risk the performance. And unfortunately, some of our clients really experience that. That even though they think now it's the right time to start a change initiative and agile everywhere, design thinking everywhere, the first thing they see is people start kind of to lessen that performance. Really interesting. And what I was saying, obsessed with what should be stable before you discuss change really helps people lose that fear and win confidence. And I'm going to talk about this a bit more. We have obsessed as a species with stability in the past. And I guess for good reasons. I mean, the Romans invented this kind of organizational structure for their military and for their administration. Imagine Germany 2,000 years ago. It looked different, I can promise. And I try to kind of get tax contributions from German gorillas. I mean, yeah, you need this very stable system, yeah, in that kind of swampland here. To get anything done, right, and organized. So they came up with a structure where every responsibility is very carefully balanced and discussed, which means it's completely impossible to change anything. The system is designed to be unchangeable. And that's why the church and the military and everybody kind of, who is still on Earth now for 2,000 years, is so happy with that system. It is not designed to innovate. There are other companies who experiment with ways to design their organization for innovation. This is one example from our film Augenhöhe and our book Management Why, where you can take a second to wonder, like, who are the leaders and where are they in this organizational diagram? I think I have only half an hour for this talk and we lost already some time. So it's those guys in the triangles here. They see themselves as Schwunggeber, as, I don't know, energy creators or whatever. And the team in the middle are the ones who really do the actual client-centric work. And the circle outside are service functions with funny names because they focus on what really matters for the company. So there's one shared service center for enthusiasm, for productivity, one for talent, and one for the obvious, like infrastructure for projects to be successful and to be safe and less risky. And I think talent, to me, is the most important thing. I really iterate on this one. I have worked in 6 companies, I think, in my 20 years career, and I love starting new stuff. That's my nature. Others have an even longer tenure. My longest tenure was at P&G for 6 years, and it's been good to stay long. In hindsight, I think I see so many people in the projects that we do who are at the edge of leaving just because they think, like, you guys go, and this is not my business. I cannot change anything here. I think it's so crucial to retain those people. companies should really obsess on retaining those people who are the Querdenkers, the creatives. And I mean, you guys know this, but the others have a hard time believing this. So our goal really of our small consulting boutique is to help organizations, or to help people, to help the individuals get more effective at changing the organization before they leave. So ideally they can stay, because when you are at the company, of course, you have the networks, you have credibility, you have all the levers, all the insights. You, as a consultant, of course, I have a longer ramp to become effective than people who are inside the company. So we need, so also in the project, it's so crucial to leverage the internal people. You cannot do change from the outside. And you can do so many funky things inside the organization. This is in a German headquarter. It's one of those German companies with a six-digit number of people. And they have invited employees to design their own office with less budget than they spend normally per desk. And then people went to IKEA, but also to eBay. And the interesting thing about this experiment is that people actually work there. So when I went there to see it, it was being used by people. And I know many other funky offices in startups here in Berlin, as well as in large corporations with beautifully designed offices. Everything is perfect from an aesthetic perspective, but an outsider has created it in the best interest of the company, obviously, and still, it wasn't invented here. It's not ours. This seems to have the ownership of the people, and the advantage is they cannot complain. So from leadership's perspective, it's much wiser. Yeah? Why don't we engage everybody? Like, I mean, people have their own living rooms designed and their own bedrooms designed, so why shouldn't they collaborate on designing their workspaces? And it's such a great tool also to help people get used to collaborating in creative spaces when it's really about their own needs. And then only let's focus on starting to get creative on customer needs. We can practice with ourselves. That's something that's so important also for leadership, I think, to practice with ourselves. And I get to this also in a minute. Another aspect is how can we design leadership principles in general. And there was a guy with his name called Mikhail Csikszentmihalyi. It took me years to pronounce the name, and it's Ukrainian, but he lived and worked in the US. And he has been researching high-performance sports people, politicians, entrepreneurs, CEOs. Like, what made it possible for you? What are the factors that you could perform at that peak performance for decades? Not just for a project, but for decades, for many years. And he, in the end, nailed it down to those three factors that Dan Pink later popularized in one of his books. People will not perform, I put it this way, if they don't have the autonomy. This is so obvious. Like, you are 18 years old, driving the car for the first time. Your daddy helps you drive the car and the steering wheel. No autonomy. It's no fun. You won't learn. Purpose, if it doesn't make sense for you what you do, you will not engage. You will not give good performance. Why? It doesn't make sense for you. You will somehow function. Mastery, if I am overwhelmed with what I'm asked to do, if it is beyond my skills, I will not perform because I will struggle, either with shame because I'm not good enough, or with actual problems because I don't perform well. I don't get done what I want to do. So it's those three super simple factors. And when I worked at P&G, I realized only years after that, when I was trained in P&G management, at those days, I think it's five factors today, I heard, but at the time it was triple E. Leading at P&G was triple E. Empower your people, envision them, enable them. And it came to me only when after I left that, yes, this is flow. That's Csikszentmihalyi's research, I guess. Yeah. So by training leaders to see themselves as servants to the organization, people who are not seeing themselves as my team serves me because I have all those needs of status, prestige, and so on. But people who ask their team members, what do you need? Can you work here well? Can you perform? Is something in your way? Do you think you have enough autonomy, mastery, and purpose in what you do? It's such a difference. And the important factor is not only you for the team, but also to care for yourself. I think selfishness is completely misunderstood in many places, because in one way we design the organizations for people to be selfish. We still give people individual bonuses in so many companies and ask them for team play. So if I help my colleague, it's going to be good for his bonus, so why should I do this? And this is still a reality in many companies. On the other hand, obviously team play and innovation in particular needs collective action and not selfish action. I think selfishness in my understanding and our understanding is to also see that you have those things in order to live well. And to go to your management or to your team and ask them, hey guys, I think I need more autonomy. Or I don't think my mastery is good enough at this. Right? So that kind of selfishness I can only encourage. And you see from the examples that office design, organizational design, leadership principles, this is the easy stuff to talk about, right? It's still something that deals with structure and control in a way, and that's always easy to talk, and if it's successful, then it's great because it's so obvious. I enforced this, that happened, thank you guys, right? This right-hand side is the soft stuff, it's the subtle stuff, it's the difficult, the delicate stuff, because how many of you executives speak about spirit? They may speak about purpose these days, I'm really glad for this, and it's hard to define the purpose of an organization, like what it's good for. Who are we serving? That's a difficult question. It's worth a two-day workshop, for sure, to explore this. But what's the spirit of our organization? Like when somebody walks into the office building and they just have that sensation that you all know. You walk into a place and you know the spirit of the place, a family, a kindergarten, an office, a shop. Spirit is something like what matters here. Spirit is a sentiment that we have for, am I going to be safe? Is it going to be good for me to be here? And for collaboration, for work, to provide psychological safety, as Google found out, it's just so crucial that the spirit also is being discussed and can be discussed. And self-organization and responsibility is a good way there, and it's difficult. So if we get back to the question, okay, for these kids, like if the guy here in the front right for you has the idea, oh, we played with these things, so let's play something else. Let's play catch me. What can he do? Yeah. If I go back, should he try to control this? Like, you promised yesterday that we play the other game now. Yeah. Not really inspiring. Or should he try to, like, if this happens frequently, okay, every Tuesday Tom can define the game, every Wednesday Steve can define the game. I mean, it doesn't feel appropriate, right? This is about daily business, and for this one it's super important. Right? But for changing the daily business, it feels a bit awkward to see it this way. So what kind of spirit can help Tom change the game here? What's the secret? I don't know if there's a secret. And my hard time today is normally I have more time to also invite you to reflect during and after the conversation and also have conversations with each other because many of those things you have inside you anyway. And I can only kind of put the focus on things. This is nothing for experts to tell you what to do and stand here. All I can do is invite you. What I invite you to is if change was like this, I think everybody would embrace it. And again, and sorry for the many childhood examples, but I think they are so simple. Actually, is George Campbell still here? Yeah. Hi, yeah. We talked a couple of years ago, you've forgotten, but you told me one really important thing. You said, I asked you, like, what's the purpose of your job? And you were saying, I help people unlearn what they've learned. And I just loved that, and I kept spreading it to the world, because it is really part of what you do and what we in the room do and what I do, is we help people unlearn. And this also, in part, may mean to get back to whatever was important in their childhood and reactivate those resources. It may have been buried in command and control structures and the power also we have. So for change to be a discovery, like this kid, imagine the kid being at the beginning of that sleigh, it's called, I think, the Rutsche, right? Like, ooh, looking down, this is scary, should I do this? Should I, no, it goes down, I will lose control, right? And you all know this, the kid goes down, yup, and then what does it do? What's happening? Again, right? So they run as fast as they can back to the ladder, and walk it up, and then down again, right? And this is our mantra for Management Y, for the idea of how can a Generation Y kind of leadership help companies have that kind of energy about change. Oh, this felt good. Let's try it again. And I'll speak about this at the end. And I think why this is also so important, the childhood stuff, is if we are serious about ourselves, even though I also love Apple stuff and iPhones, but we are not designed for technology. We are designed to survive in that kind of unknown space. Designed, I mean, we have evolved into surviving here. And our desires and fears are there to help us survive in the unknown. And I think a change project or initiative or cultural change is not much different from having to survive in the jungle, right? It's unknown stuff. Everything can happen every day. It's not predictable. And just a very quick walkthrough, so some of the human needs, there's lots of great research on this, that we often focus mainly on performance, right? Like if you think of like what drives people's energy in many organizations and what kind of desires do we fuel and nurture with our incentive system, it's about performing. But all the other things, to belong, is so important in many German companies in particular. Yeah. Einmal bei der Bank, immer bei der Bank. I mean, there are many examples of like how important belonging is. To collaborate well is something that becomes more important these days. To be listened is a motivation for every leader. You lead because you have a desire to be listened and followed. And if people don't follow you, then you're not a leader. Yeah. To know it all, this is the expert's dream in conjunction with high performance and comparison. So, management, that many of you and also you talked about as a contrast, in our view is something that at best helps people perform and organize well. Leadership is looking at the quality of collaboration. And I think it's entrepreneurship that really gives people room for the joy of helping others have what they need. A great Silicon Valley entrepreneur can make a number of years in investment rounds with just the idea of getting rich. But at some point, the person or his leadership team will have also the capacity to give others what they need beyond money and success. This is what, but at least in our research, is the DNA of most successful entrepreneurs and companies who really lasted for long. And this is now theory. I think in practice, it looks like that. You all discussed empathy. So if you're the trainer on that surfboard, what can you do to help this apparent beginner to learn and to grow? You have to be so empathic on that board, right, with the person. Like, what does she need right now? How can I support that growth, that she learns the skills of standing on that shaky board in the water? This is the skill, I think, very tangibly again, that you can provide to everybody around you in the organization to feel comfortable about change. It's that kind of capacity to sense what's happening here. This is not a playbook thing, like do this first and then that and then that. It's all about being now and here and sensing that. What does she need? What do they need? Hard to discuss. This is about sensing. Another very important thing is what matters to you will matter to the others if you are a leader, if they follow you. I go back. This means in this slide, if control, which is basically a need to survive, right? You want to enforce things to happen. Or if just performance is what matters to you, this will matter to people. Innovation in the first place is like research. There is not much to perform. You cannot count ideas per month. It's hard to quantify the quality of ideas, right? So true innovation also means to let go of this obsession with performance, for instance, and rather focus on collaboration, for instance. Or rather focus on listening yourself, or, right? So whatever of those human needs, or you can have your own list of needs, this is just one example. Whatever your needs are, that you or your desires that you find important, stability, predictability, monthly reports, clarity, you force your people to respect them, right, in a hierarchy in particular. So how can innovation happen in a space where predictability is the key? And this conversation is easy to have with every manager, like what matters for you? And do you think that those desires of yours really help innovation to grow? In practical terms, I would assume that for most of our clients, the left-hand side is what counts. And they can have as many innovation projects as they want. They can acquire as many startups or pump as much money in venture capital as they want. As long as this is what counts and counts deeply inside the people, the leaders, then it's so difficult to create room for the other side. But all of you who are engaged in real innovation know that without any of these, you can forget innovation. You can forget research. It doesn't work. It will give shiny, shishy results, but not breakthrough. forgiving. I mean, this is such a hard to speak word in German. This is like, whew, Bible. I don't know. Yeah. But obviously, if there are mistakes, and whenever people really innovate, there will be mistakes. They need forgiveness. They need to trust that they will be forgiven for making mistakes. Very hard for a classical German, European, and I guess global leader in industries that normally don't innovate to be forgiving of that kind. And there was another great research by a guy called Doug McGregor about X and Y work styles. Like, in our phrases, very simple, like to work like machines is seductive, right? It's cool. If my organization, 2,000 people, not my man, just work like machines, it's great. The numbers are correct, the forecasts to the board are correct, to the shareholders, everything works with precision. But this is, and this is what so many companies are used to, but this is not the soil for innovation. The soil for innovation is to be adaptable and human. Tim Brown, who I think all of you know very well, has given a very nice talk 4 years ago that addresses another vital aspect for you as designers in particular, if you are one. Because the seduction of the designer is that I am the artist, it's my design, and you will implement that. Being an architect, a font designer, print, whatever your profession is in detail, Tim's input was, let's abandon the idea of the blueprint, meaning I make the blueprint, you execute that. There should be an iterative process, there should be an emergent process, and it's a very nice talk, where he really embraces and describes the idea of agility with his own words in order to help designers see, hey guys, you need to involve the people. And design thinking is a way to do that, but still this idea of, in the end, we are the innovators and you guys follow is still there. So it's so crucial to involve the people and really co-create. And for instance, I designed this workshop and led it as a facilitator, and there are workshop formats for participation where people at some point do it themselves and you can really step out. And I took the photograph myself, even though I was the facilitator, from the upper floor, because there are so many proven ways for participation to run even without that mastery of that super designer, of that super coach, when people really get the trust that they can do it. Our biggest antagonist here is the comfort zone, definitely. We cannot imagine that there will be a brighter future if we leave the comfort zone. And this is another great idea by Jeremy Abbott of Google. We cannot imagine, because that's one of our brain limitations, that there is a better world possible in the world that we have built ourselves. If I am running a 2,000 company organization, then I believe that this is what I have developed, and how can I ever give this up? And I think the crucial point to start change is that we take the guts and just have to trust that there will be a better world possible, even though I leave what I've been creating. It's much easier if I can take it like this, if I see small steps. It's so important to join forces with people, never do anything alone. Yeah, share your fears, share your ideas, and trust that the other person will do well with them. And back to the idea of this inner, the quest for stability, right? Many years ago, I realized I'm complaining so often. And honestly, many of the people I have worked with, in particular in change-oriented functions, like design or culture development teams or agile coaches, if management did that, and that's so bad, and so on. At some point, I realized, complaining doesn't really help. And when I do it, actually, and I did a workshop with myself to discover, like, what am I longing for when I'm complaining? And for me personally, it's I want to see beauty. I want to contribute, and I want to inspire. And that's why I complain. And complaining is a stupid idea to get there. So this became my personal mantra and stance 9 years ago. Yeah, and I can only invite you as people who want to bring change to define your own stance. It could be along those lines. Like, what are the behaviors of yours that don't lead to what you want, but what's the good at them? What's the good about complaining? This was the question I asked myself. Like, what for do I complain? And I found those points, and they still guide me till today. Last point here, because I see that the time is, I'm at 10:32 on my watch. So this sounds intellectual, but it's really about body. If we only see ourselves as that little circle at the top, then we disregard the entire capacity that we have as mammals. All our sensations, our gut feeling, all this is so disregarded in most companies. And I think it's really important to balance here. So when I stand here and advocate a certain, like if I advocate joy, rigor is important too. I think we have overdone the rigor part, so how can we nurture joy? Yeah, direction is important, but we have overdone it. How can we encourage participation? Stability, as I outlined, is overdone. Intellect is overdone. The outer success stories, the outer world is overdone, and we don't even have language or habits for sharing about how we really feel. We don't do this. So we have been overdoing the outer side. Fear has been overdone because most companies lead by fear. And many times we are asked to help run change projects, and change means to enforce something, right? This creates nothing but fear. How can we help people find desire? And connectedness is also one of my favorites. And separation is important too. There is no clarity without separation. There is no yes without a no. So I think when we think of learning from nature, balance is what we really look for. And we are running a couple of workshops, and starting next year also as public workshops for people to discover this themselves. It involves things like silence, but also discovering your needs with Lego. And body work is also important. There are many things you can do. Many folks do yoga. I used to like it until I discovered yoga is about performing, doing it well. I love Feldenkrais, and I've done this now for 3 years. Feldenkrais is the idea of learning to get to know your body from the inside without having to do anything, and still you develop. It's super interesting also as an attitude for leading. How can you lead without enforcing? It's the same as with the kids, with the game. You cannot enforce the change, you can only invite it. In the book that Toby mentions, we have 2 minutes, 1.5. We have collected many proven examples how to start. One key question is, how can we invite people as early as possible to contribute? So not just kind of give input, what do you want, but really to contribute, to be responsible. Another super important cornerstone is to build a parallel hierarchy or many hierarchies next to the old one. You will have a very hard time change anything about this Roman stuff here, but every change that you do, every small project can be in a separate hierarchy, and can there are companies who have thousands of hierarchies now, just because they redefined the notion of a hierarchy, and those people connect and form guilds, and when we work with them, then they come up with ideas like, okay, we lead whatever change program, and that's what makes them proud. And their own kind of hierarchy where they are becomes less and less important. So it's a good idea to have people form these kind of guilds and not just one with one change leader for the company. Yeah? Encourage people to lead from every position where they are and connect and drive and use their desires, I've given you a list, and their skills, yeah, to drive what they find important and to care for the others. You can track metrics for this, which I think is super important because management wants that stability. Again, it's not only about change, it's about stability and then change from there. So people want to see progress. Also, the players want to see progress. And in summarizing, it's those three things. It's developing ourselves and the quality of our relationships, and then help others develop from that. If you do this, you call it the ratchet effect. So the ratchet is the thing that only goes in one direction. Yeah, and it's a tool. So if it's inviting, I think this is the most important part. If your change initiatives are inviting, then you have a much higher success of it to be joyful. And in our experience, nobody who has gotten to work with design thinking well, or with Agile and Scrum principles well, or any other kind of modern stuff that people can do that is more humane, they don't want back, right? There is no programmer who works in the Scrum team who ever wants to go back to the old world. And I just love this comment that a person made to me when we filmed Augenhöhe. He was saying, and this was at a very developed company, he was saying, I wish that at home it was a bit more like at work. Because they really had gotten the quality of their relationship so well that now he started to realize the shortcomings of his own personal life. Thank you. I spoke for 35 minutes. Perfect. Bit over that.
Thank you very much. Round of applause.